would you by any chance be the star of a play that has recently opened in New York?
I wish I were.
That's one down, nine to go, Miss Francis.
But are you someone who has appeared in the theater?
Definitely.
Mr. Lawrence?
Have you also appeared in motion pictures?
Definitely.
Miss Kilgallen?
Did you win an Academy Award and are you Tulu the Bankhead?
That's two down and eight to go, Mr. Serb.
Who was it wrote about you that on stage you were a flame, but off stage you were a wisp of smoke? Remember that?
I think it was John Van Truten.
Right.
Yes.
During I'm a Camera, probably. Yes. Something like that.
He also called me a glass of water.
he mixes metaphors.
But I loved him for saying those things because he was really saying that I was like a wisp of smoke, that you were hardly conscious of me being there. And suddenly I was given the ingredients of a part and I became something else.
If there is one continuity today at the Academy Awards, then it is actors being nominated for playing real-life characters. In the last 20 years or so, we got June Carter and Johnny Cash, Queen Elizabeth I, Queen Elizabeth II, Stephen Hawking, Virginia Woolf, Ray Charles, Edith Piaf, Julia Child, King George VI, Judy Garland, Freddie Mercury, and so on and so forth.
And Humphrey had just about moved into the hotel bar.
Humphrey Bogart.
Where he and John Houston.
I mean, this trend is not completely new. After all, we just discussed Susan Hayward's nominated performance as real-life singer Jane Froman, and we already saw this fascination of the Academy with performances based on real-life people all the way back to the 30s.
Won't you come in, Monsieur Ziegfeld?
But it was still not the norm as it is today. During the 50s and 60s, there was another continuity instead. Actors and actresses receiving nominations for movies based on stage productions, as there was a strong connection between Hollywood and Broadway. Not just the expected Tennessee Williams heroines, but all kinds of roles, from dumb blondes to historic figures, and of course musicals.
Come!
With these nominations, there are two possibilities. One, the performer in the movie did not play the part previously on the stage. Think of Julie Andrews in The Sound of Music, Frederick March in Death of a Salesman, or Grace Kelly in The Country Girl. The second option, a stage performer is allowed to recreate his or her role on the big screen. Think of Paul Scofield in A Man for All Seasons, Geraldine Page in Sweet Bird of Youth, or Judy Holliday in Born Yesterday.
You're crazy about me, aren't you?
In the early decades of the Academy, we see trend number two quite regularly, and no year better symbolizes this than 1952, when not just one, but two stage actresses entered the Best Actress competition. It was a true East versus West. New York versus Hollywood, stars of the screen versus stars of the stage.
Miss Elliot, Mr. Bailey's a very good actor. He's worked for me in New York.
Oh, how nice. We can use good actors.
And what makes this even more unique is that Julie Harris and Shirley Booth were not only stars of the stage, but rather true Broadway giants. And even if they were both at different places in 1952, their careers still shared many similarities. Between the two of them, they won 8 Tony Awards. Both received their Oscar nominations for their movie debuts, neither of them would ever receive another nomination again or had a significant movie career, both clearly preferring the stage to the screen, but also facing the typical barriers of the movie industry that did not see them as suitable screen actresses in the long run.
This small, soft-spoken lady has done several one-woman shows alone on the stage for 2 hours at a stretch, 8 shows a week, week after week. She says it's like climbing the rock face of a mountain. It requires determination and stamina. If you don't have a strong presence, you have to learn it. Learn how to reach from the first row all the way to the last. You have to learn to say, here I am.
And what Julie and Shirley also had in common as actresses was their desire to act right from their childhood. Shirley would appear in Sunday school programs where she quickly realized that she loved both performing and the applause of the audience. No one could convince me that I was not going on the stage. And I figured I'd be pretty darn good too. Julie Harris equally became interested in acting from a young age, remembering, there were a few things I could do well. One of them was to mimic people. Another was to do little improvisations that made people laugh. It never occurred to me as a little girl that I could take the small talent that I had and build a life around it.
when did you have these visions you're talking about of being able to go in the attic and put on these personalities and adopt these different persona?
I think it started there when I was 10, 11, 12.
That early then?
That early. We saw a lot of theater touring companies coming through the Detroit at the Cass Theater, the Schubert, and I was taken to see the Lunts and Morris Evans in Hamlet and Catherine Cornell in The Doctor's Dilemma and ever so many things, and Helen Hayes and all the popular shows of the day.
Shirley Booth also realized at a young age that acting was a way to make a living, but unlike Julie Harris, she had to fight against the disapproval of her father, who was strictly against her ambitions. She later said, "It was my father who made me an actress, which was the last thing he wanted. I was so dominated by him that I felt shadowy. I didn't have any identity, so I escaped to the only place where I could be a definite personality, on the stage."
Do you think Dad would mind very much if I came home for a little while?
Both Julie Harris and Shirley Booth shared a passion for acting that made it the main focus of their lives. Julie remembered, "The only things that really meant anything to me in high school, the only things I really cared about, were drama classes and after-school drama activities. Acting was all that mattered." And Shirley had equal thoughts during her youth. "By the time I was a teenager, nothing other than acting seemed worthwhile. And that wasn't because acting seemed to be the road to great wealth. I merely wanted to act." But while their ambitions were equal, their ways to acting as a profession were different. After high school, Julie Harris would attend Yale Drama School and then go to New York and to the Actors Studio, where she also met director Ilya Kazan.
The Actors Studio was probably the most exciting actors workshop in the world.
Well, it was for me, and still is going, yes, as a theater school in New York and in Los Angeles, I believe, mm-hmm. too. And the Stanislavski method, which was the inspiration for the Actors Studio, emphasizes that the more you know about the person you're playing, the better it is. And so if you know their background, if you can recall their childhood, I mean, it does. It makes it so...
It colors it to you.
Yes.
Shirley Booth, on the other hand, would start her career without any formal training. She auditioned for local stock companies and, thanks to her natural talents and unique personality, became a member of the Poly Players in New Haven, Connecticut. As part of the company, she played more than 600 different roles. This quick changing of parts, from romantic leads to comedic supporting roles, gained her a lot of experience and would later allow her to switch easily between different genres, between leading and supporting roles. For Shirley Booth, the art of acting was learning by doing. As she said, "I was never in a dramatic school in my life, but I watch people always, how they look and talk and behave. When the time comes, and with theatrical license, of course, I draw on that stock." This is certainly the main difference between Julie Harris and Shirley Booth, and it's unclear if the two of them would have gotten along together in a production. When Shirley Booth later in her career appeared in the play By the Beautiful Sea, one of her co-stars, a young actress by the name of Joanne Woodward, heavily annoyed her for spending too much time on rehearsing and wondering about the motives of her character. It was a method acting approach for which Shirley Booth had no patience, simply saying, "She's gotta go."
Were you kind of a lone...
Yes, I've always been a solitary person.
I wondered.
Yes, but I love being alone.
You do?
I do.
People don't believe that anyone can, you know?
I know. I feel sorry for those people. I feel awfully sorry for people who can't find things to do mm-hmm. because I get so much satisfaction out of so many little things.
In 1925, Shirley Booth would start her Broadway career in the play Hell's Bells with Humphrey Bogart. From then on, she would regularly appear on the stage. Among her biggest hits during this time were Three Men on a Horse, a supporting role in The Philadelphia Story, and the lead in My Sister Eileen. In these parts, she found success as a witty, wisecracking career woman, establishing a strong reputation with critics and theater audiences who adored her versatility. About her work in The Philadelphia Story, one critic wrote, "Kate was the showpiece, Shirley was the actress." While Shirley Booth had a strong standing with both critics and audiences, she began to experience a very familiar fear for actresses, that her age would soon limit the parts available to her and damage her career overall. And so she began to reduce her real age by a good decade. It's obviously hard to say if her career would have been different without this step. She was, after all, extremely popular in the Broadway community, but there's no sense in denying that opportunities begin to decline for actresses very quickly once they reach a certain age, and so Shirley Booth's worries are understandable. And hiding the truth about her age was apparently successful for her because A. The whole topic was never discussed and apparently simply accepted by everyone, and B. She would reach the absolute peak of her stardom and acclaim beginning in 1948 at the age of 50, when everybody assumed that she was actually 40, when she appeared in a featured role in Goodbye My Fancy, again showcasing her skill for witty wisecracking, and won her very first Tony Award. But it was her next project that opened in 1950 that would establish Shirley Booth once and for all as one of Broadway's greatest actresses. And 1 month prior to this premiere, Julie Harris also had her big breakthrough. After she joined the Actors Studio in New York, she appeared in 10 different Broadway productions between 1945 and 1950. None of them was a big success, but she highly valued the experience she gained during these years. Her career would then change forever when she was cast in the play The Member of the Wedding, the story of 12-year-old troubled adolescent Frankie who wants to understand and find a place in the world. Co-starring Ethel Waters and 7-year-old Brandon DeWilder, the play was a critical hit and ran for over 500 performances.
Miss Harris has been showing promise, and it's in quotations, in comparatively small parts for the past 2 or 3 seasons. And in this new play, she makes good on the promise, playing to perfection a long, hard role. Let's show them the picture. That must bring back some very pleasant memories for you.
Oh, yes. With Ethel Waters. That was one of the extraordinary moments of my life, to be with Ethel for 1.5 years in that play, and Brandon, that little angel. Yes, Brandon DeWilder. Yes, it was a wonderful experience for me.
I always felt that Ethel was the greatest actor I ever worked with, and she was a force of nature. She reminded me of the first time I saw the Niagara Falls. I thought the power and the beauty, and the spirituality and the violence, it was all there in that one human person. Being. Yes.
The success was especially satisfying because for Julie Harris, it wasn't a sure thing. Playing a 12-year-old at the age of 25 was obviously a big challenge for her.
I was 12 years out of adolescence, and I was still pretty skinny and gangly myself, although I wasn't as tall as Frank.
In terms of your getting into the frame of mind.
But Harold said to me, don't try to be young.
Oh, really?
Like you would be saying, like when I played Driving Miss Daisy, he would have said to me, don't try to be old. But you are encased in whatever you're encased in, and you are going through a series of emotions, and that's what you should be thinking of, not how old you are, but what is it that's happening to you.
It was very important advice in her career, and one that would guide her for the years to come. She herself described her approach to the role, you have to tell yourself, right now, I might not be able to see myself do this particular thing, so I must work with my imagination so that I can. Walking around barefoot and in a raggedy shirt took me back to my own childhood and helped me to put me in the spirit of the role. And she also recognized that the part of Frankie was too demanding to cast with an age-appropriate actress, like they had done with the role of John Henry. Actors get better with age. Children often make marvelous actors because they have not learned yet to intellectualize what they do. They feel something on stage. They express this feeling honestly and clearly. But there are times when the process is not as simple and direct. No child, no matter how gifted, is going to be believable as Macbeth or Hamlet or Juliet.
You were in your 20s then.
I was 24.
And you were playing a 12-year-old.
Yes.
Frankie Adams, F. Jasmine Adams.
F. Jasmine Adams, 12 3/4 years old.
Reviewers certainly were highly impressed by Julie's ability to portray a 12-year-old teenager, calling her perfection, splendid and remarkable, and that her astonishing performance made Frankie one of the most interesting south of the border females since Scarlett O'Hara, and Julie Harris a true successor to Broadway giant Helen Hayes. As Julie said, suddenly I was in the business. I was an actress. But she was not just an actress, but from one night to the next, a full-blown Broadway star, an exciting discovery, a golden girl, a cover girl, the girl next door, the girl on the moon, profiled, covered, revealed, reported, what she eats and what she wears, and whom she knows and where she was and when and where she's going. You know what I mean.
She was the most acclaimed young actress in America. I want to inhabit my characters, she said, to bring them alive. Every night I pray to be truthful.
In their early years, the Tony Awards had no nominations but only announced the year's winners. If there had been nominees, it's pretty safe to assume that both Julie and Ethel Waters, who also saw overwhelming praise for her work, would have been surefire contenders in the leading actress category.
She said I was the right height and had acting talent and ought to go to Hollywood. She did, Bernice.
Okay, all right, she did.
She said I was a lovely size and I probably wouldn't grow any taller.
However, a win for their work was pretty much out of the question, because 1 month after The Member of the Wedding, another play opened on Broadway with a leading performance that captured New York by storm. Shirley Booth had almost turned down the leading role in William Inge's play Come Back Little Sheba. She knew the role was great, but it was also too downbeat for her at this time. After friends in the theater personally appealed to her to reconsider, she finally agreed to play the role that would become the signature part of her career. Lola Delaney, the suffering wife of an alcoholic husband.
You know, it ain't like before. Nobody'd see you getting drunk, 'cause you don't get drunk anymore.
During the tryouts, Shirley played an important part in shaping the character of Lola. William Ing was not too well known at this time, and desperate in need of a hit. The casting of a popular stage actress like Shirley Booth was therefore a blessing, and he was open to suggestions by Shirley about the right way to approach her part. Originally written more villainous, she saw Lola as a woman shaped by her tragic life and a victim of circumstances. As she had always done, she would also observe people while walking around New York, slowly collecting all the characteristics she would later use for Lola. She saw her task in the role as, all I had to do was prove to the audience that Lola was a colossal bore, without boring the audience.
Are you sorry you married me?
Of course not.
I mean, are you sorry you had to marry me?
When the play opened in Westport, word of mouth quickly showed that Shirley had succeeded in this regard. Praise for her and character actor Sidney Blackmer in the role of Lola's husband quickly reached New York. Sidney Blackmer remembered Tallulah Bankhead one night standing on her chair and shouting her approval during the curtain call. And when the show opened on Broadway in February 1950, Shirley had once and for all established herself as Broadway's most celebrated actress, as critics called it the best performance of her career and one of the best ever seen on Broadway in general, a tour de force of the highest order. The play itself was met with less enthusiasm, and it would only run for about 200 performances. The depressive tone of the story clearly turned off many audience members, but whatever success Come Back Little Sheba enjoyed could clearly be traced back to Shirley Booth and Sidney Blackmer, both of whom would also win Tony Awards for their work. Fellow Broadway legend Helen Hayes later said about Shirley, "She has perfect timing and perfect reading, and always has complete control of herself, her part, and her audience. I have often gone back to watch her a second and a third time, trying to figure out how she does it. Because the first time she has made it seem so effortless that I have forgotten I'm watching an actress." So 1950 had been a banner year for both Julie Harris and Shirley Booth. Julie was on her way to the top, Shirley confirmed her position there. And both would continue the success. After the depressive nature of Come Back Little Sheba, Shirley Booth took a comedic supporting role in the musical version of A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, for which she received top billing. Her name was by now enough to draw in an audience. Julie Harris, on the other hand, would originate the role of Sally Bowles, yes, that Sally Bowles, in the play I Am a Camera, based on Christopher Isherwood's Goodbye to Berlin. Her playing of the fun-loving Sally contrasted sharply with the performance in The Member of the Wedding and would further strengthen her reputation as one of Broadway's most relevant young stars, along newcomer Audrey Hepburn, who was making a splash with Gigi the same year. Julie would also win her first Tony for I Am a Camera in 1952, a year that was again very important for both her and Shirley Booth.
Shirley Booth, the award-winning star whose electric talents made Come Back, Little Sheba the most honored and most discussed Broadway stage hit in years.
Despite her success on the Broadway stage, Shirley Booth was not a sure thing for the big screen adaptation of Come Back, Little Sheba after producer Hal Wallace had acquired the movie rights. She made a screen test for Paramount, but she had never made a movie before and was largely unknown outside of New York. Executives wondered how likely it was that a 54-year-old character actress could make this movie a success. Of course, everyone believed her to be in her early 40s, but it's not like this age is perceived any better in Hollywood. And so Paramount executives began to look for other names for the role, other actresses above 40 who at least already had a screen reputation, like Shirley's 1952 co-nominees Joan Crawford and Bette Davis.
Did you ever turn one down when, you know, 5 days later you were just kicking yourself all over the place?
Well, not for, I turned down Goodbye, Little Sheba when Mr. Wallace asked me to play it, because I felt it was totally a difficult part for me. I felt that if I played, wasn't it Goodbye, Little Sheba, yes. I felt that drunken husband would have been out of the house inside about 1 week. Because there are certain things in a personality one cannot disguise. And playing a very sort of fey, which Booth did so brilliantly, I didn't feel was right for me. I was sorry I didn't do that.
But obviously, producers also thought about going younger for the movie version, with the likes of Judy Holliday, who was already familiar with Hollywood's casting policies and would have none of it. They spent 2 years trying to find out who should play my part in Born Yesterday. And then they spent 2 years trying to figure out who should play Shirley's part in Sheba. And then they decide I should play her part. Can you imagine? Essentially, every actress offered the role of Lola declined with more or less the same words. This is Shirley's role, and only Shirley should play it. And finally, Hal Wallace agreed. Shirley's co-star Sidney Blackmer was not so lucky. As it was the case 30 years later with the movie version of Educating Rita, producers insisted that if an unknown was cast as the female lead, then they needed a more well-known name as her co-star. After actors like Humphrey Bogart or Gregory Peck had been considered for the role of the alcoholic husband, the final casting decision shocked both Hollywood and New York. Burt Lancaster was not considered a primary dramatic actor or a suitable fit for the alcoholic husband of Shirley Booth, especially because, as this seems to be a theme for this year, he was also more than a decade younger than his co-star. Of course, officially, he was only a few years younger, but again, in times that saw actresses like Grace Kelly or Audrey Hepburn constantly paired with actors who could be their fathers, the obviousness of the age dynamic was unusual. Burt Lancaster was also skeptical about the whole situation at first, but then began to enjoy his role and commented, "True, on the stage, Sidney Blackmer gave you the feeling of an older man, one in his late 50s. But in the script, he's actually indicated to be about 40, which I'll be next year." Switching from Sidney Blackmer, who was a couple of years older than Shirley Booth, to a co-star so visibly younger than herself, made Shirley uncomfortable at first as it increased her anxiety about her real age, but thanks to being so strongly associated with Lola, nobody accused her of being wrong for the part due to Bert's casting, again strengthening her self-assuredness for the project.
I was pretty then, wasn't I, Doc? Remember the first time you kissed me? You were scared as a young girl. You trembled so.
To make Shirley as comfortable as possible in front of the camera for her movie debut, and also to overcome any possible insecurities due to her new co-star, Broadway director Daniel Mann was brought to Hollywood to make his own movie debut with the direction of Come Back, Little Sheba. And while all of this was going on, Julie Harris was also preparing to make her big screen debut. But her casting in the movie version of The Member of the Wedding was far less difficult. Director Fred Zinnemann, having a career peak with High Noon the same year and From Here to Eternity the next, was to do the movie as his last project for producer Stanley Kramer. Zinnemann liked the idea as he had been moved by the novel by Carson McCullers and wanted to do a movie that would stick very close to it. However, shooting of the movie only had a very limited budget and time window, and it was therefore decided to stick mostly to the stage play and, for practical reasons, the three main stage performers were also invited to recreate their parts. After all, giving the role to Julie Harris, who was already familiar with the character, would be much easier and less time-consuming than looking for somebody new. And while many actresses of a certain age certainly would have loved to be Lola Delaney in Come Back Little Sheba, it's doubtful how many Hollywood actresses would have been willing to tackle a role like Frankie Adams.
She belonged to no club and was a member of nothing in the world. Frankie had become an unjoined person, and she was afraid.
Fred Zinnemann would always be a big admirer of the member of the wedding, saying, "My job was to transfer to the screen a work that was already powerfully alive," and he would also call it one of his favorite movies. To him, Julie Harris was also an extraordinary actress, one of the three or four finest I have ever worked with. Both Shirley and Julie noticed how movie acting demanded a different approach than stage acting. For Shirley, it was mostly reducing the volume of her voice, joking that on her first day of shooting, she spoke so loudly that the sound man almost became deaf. About the camera, she said, "I thought I had to underplay everything for the screen. Then I realized I could let myself go a little, like on the stage. Some of the things were wonderful. Others gave me the feeling that I was undressing emotionally. But as a whole, it turned out beautifully. It was a labor of love."
He keeps mumbling, "Pretty Lola.
That's me."
Julie Harris also had to reduce her performance for the screen. She remembered, "It gave me a lot of trouble. Film acting is much more precise than stage acting. The camera is a lie detector. It has no ears, but it records thoughts. It wants to see those thoughts. The main thing I had to learn is to keep searching inside myself for what is truthful, to expose my innermost feelings. Before the camera, there must be no pretense, only truth."
"Those moths could fly anywhere, yet they keep hanging around the windows of this house."
"The only time I ever sort of have a problem with the camera is if I notice it."
"Yeah.
You see, this is awkward. As far as the emotional continuity is concerned, this is really training. This is the hardest thing, of course, for the theater actress to do."
"Yes.
When she starts in films."
According to critics, Julie certainly succeeded in front of the camera, and they praised her for dropping every bit of vanity and committing herself to the part of Frankie. They maybe didn't care too much for the movie itself, calling it more static than a stage play, but they still applauded the performances, highlighting Julie Harris in a showy role and complimenting the intensity of her performance, which made Frankie the most engaging character in the movie, and that she and Ethel Waters complemented each other perfectly.
"He watches me."
"Frankie, you got the sharpest set of human bones I ever felt."
Director Fred Zinnemann never expected the member of the wedding to become a big hit. And he was certainly right. He remembered, "There was hardly any action. Everything important took place in the souls of those people. Given the public of the early 1950s, this seemed to be an enormous challenge. As it turned out, the audience was not ready for it. It was a resounding flop, declared by the establishment to be fit only for art house cinemas."
"Now I, a member of the wedding, what a phenomenal film. And you playing a 12-year-old when you were in your 20s.
Yes, I was 24.
You were 24.
And little Brandon DeWilde was about 7. You know, and Ethel Waters, I don't know how old Ethel was at that time. I think she was in her late 40s, you know. But she was so beautiful."
But big hit or not, Julie Harris had passed her movie debut test with flying colors. Just a few days later, it was Shirley's turn. And to say that her movie debut was a triumph would probably be an understatement. Reviews stated that she was one of the most remarkable actresses of our time, and that she had devastatingly recreated the slatternly Lola for the camera. Seriously, the word slatternly comes up in essentially every article. But furthermore, hers was called a rare gem in the showcase of acting, filled with complete truth, rare illumination, and tremendous integrity. In some scenes, her acting is the most tumultuous and poignant we have seen on the screen. And essentially, every review was also an immediate prediction for an Oscar nomination, maybe even the award itself.
"That's real artistic. I wish I was artistic.
Shirley Booth's movie debut certainly became one of the most unique occasions in Hollywood history. No matter if in her 40s or 50s, to see a character actress like her, certainly not bound by the traditional standards of Hollywood beauty, being embraced in such an overwhelming way in her first movie role ever, does not happen every day. And for a while it was basically impossible to open a newspaper without Shirley winning another award. She pretty much dominated the entire Oscar season. The New York Film Critics, the Hollywood Foreign Press, and the Cannes Film Festival.
I might say, if I may, without causing you too much embarrassment, that it's a great honor for us to have the young lady who got the Oscar Award and the Antoinette Perry Award and just won the award in Cannes. In fact, I think one of our New York columnists, Lyon, said the only thing you hadn't won so far was the Kentucky Derby.
Well, I almost won it yesterday, but I drew the wrong ticket in the lottery.
Unsurprisingly, an Oscar nomination for Shirley Booth followed, together with Julie Harris and the widely predicted Joan Crawford, Bette Davis, and Susan Hayward. Other names that had been speculated to varying degrees included Olivia de Havilland in her first movie since The Heiress, My Cousin Rachel, Betty Grable in The Greatest Show on Earth, Lana Turner in The Bad and the Beautiful, and Ava Gardner in The Snows of Kilimanjaro. But none of them was considered snubbed after the nominations were announced. However, there was one performance missing from this lineup that did cause a noticeable outcry from the press. Because despite all the praise for Julie Harris, her co-star Ethel Waters had seen even greater reviews for her work in the same picture. Her rendition of Eyes on a Sparrow was for many the high point of the movie, and even Julie Harris would get tears in her eyes when she talked about it years later.
So she said, well, I'd like to sing you a song that I used to sing to my grandmother. And we all said, okay. And that's when she sang His Eyes on the Sparrow.
Well,
put everybody away.
Because of the praise, there was quite a lot of speculation that Ethel Waters would be the first woman of color to be nominated for a Best Actress Oscar, which outrageously was not to be. Some outlets blamed category confusion, as some saw Ethel Waters as supporting, which certainly had nothing to do with the size of the role, but rather with the fact that she was an African-American playing a maid, which probably made it impossible for many to see her as a leading actress. Yeah.
Fuck you.
But even with Ethel Waters in the running, it would not have altered the outcome. Shirley Booth was quite simply one of the surest winners in Oscar history. The Daily Variety poll, conducted usually among 20% of all Academy members, stated that, while some categories continued to be nail-biters, a victory for Shirley was undeniable. In a fight of Broadway versus Hollywood, Broadway was the clear winner, as most outlets also thought that Julie Harris was the only possible alternative to Shirley Booth. But some also predicted an upset by popular hometown girl Joan Crawford. But looking at it realistically, no one was taking that Oscar away from Shirley Booth. Julie Harris was maybe the future, but Shirley was the present. She was the moment, an acting giant not to be denied, also seen as America's answer to the realism that was coming across the Atlantic. Actresses like Anna Magnani or Simone Signore had maybe not yet made their big splash in Hollywood, but their names became more and more known and their acting style, as well as those of other European performers, often made the acting of American performers seem more artificial in comparison. Of course, there was already a new generation of American actors emerging, including Julie Harris, whose work would shape stage and movie acting in the years to come, but in 1952, Shirley's performance, without the actor studio or method acting behind it, which was still regarded dubiously by many members of the Hollywood community, was seen as America's realism, almost as a next step in movie acting.
There's a school of thought that thinks that actors should completely identify with themselves with a character. I think it's called the method. Do you approve of this?
Well, no, I don't. Because it probably dates me that I've... it's just not for me. I must be fair and say, maybe it is for some people. But I think it's a very untheatrical kind of acting. Yeah. You know, not that I don't think films, the prime requisite is a certain reality, but there is a certain way of giving a performance to your audience. And I think this is a little bit like peeking through keyholes at real life.
I just don't really understand it at all. Don't like it, I must say.
Do you think the method has been kind of given a bad rap?
Well, it was, I think, probably in the 50s, mm-hmm. because great actors like Marlon Brando and James Dean, who I acted with, I was in a film with Marlon. Sometimes people would say, I can't understand them, they mumble.
And how did Shirley do it? It's obviously hard to tell, but she combined the ordinary with the unusual. Audiences felt that they knew women like Shirley Booth, but at the same time they were surprised by the depths of her emotions and feelings. How she could insert a familiar personality into different genres. And many critics were also quite simply overwhelmingly happy about the fact that an actress like Shirley, who made her career on the stage against all odds, had this moment in the sun.
I'm gonna see that you get a letter if I have to write it myself.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
The only challenge to a possible win by either Shirley Booth or Julie Harris was that some critics grew tired of actors winning Oscars for recreating their stage performances, accusing them of having it easier than actors who have to originate a role anew. A sentiment that Shirley Booth even agreed on. Following wins by the cast of A Streetcar Named Desire, or Julie Holliday, José Ferrer and Josephine Hall all in one year, there was a feeling that maybe Hollywood became too generous to Broadway actors. But this obviously did not affect the race in the end. Actress Maggie McNamara, who was starring in The Moon is Blue on Broadway and would herself be an Oscar nominee for the movie version one year later, defended Shirley Booth, stating, "It's ridiculous to say that Shirley Booth walked through Come Back Little Sheba because she was so familiar with the character. Shirley Booth never walked through anything." However, it would be 4 years before another performer won an Oscar for recreating a stage role. So maybe Hollywood did become a bit resentful after the acting sweeps between 1950 and 1952. For all her acclaim in Hollywood, Shirley Booth was not even in LA on the night of the Oscars, attending the sister show in New York instead. Neither Shirley nor Julie Harris stayed in Hollywood after the first success, and they instead went back to the stage. Shirley, now a stage and movie sensation, would return to Broadway and appear in Arthur Lawrence's The Time of the Cuckoo, for which she would win her third Tony Award, making Shirley the first actress to win an Oscar and a Tony in the same year. Between 1950 and 1953, she was the, quote, reigning first actress of the stage and screen.
Wasn't your first big hit New York and Bill Inge's Come Back Little Sheba, wasn't it?
Yes, it was, and it will be my favorite part. One of the great nights in American theater.
So let's take a look at the work by Julie and Shirley in detail now. First of all, the most obvious question. How did Julie and Shirley transfer their work from the stage to the screen? I want to say right away that both were able to adjust their performances to the intimacy of the camera mostly successfully, even if both of them occasionally feel a bit stagey in some moments. However, to different degrees and in different circumstances. But this is not meant as a general dismissal, because both Julie and Shirley surely deliver the most exciting performances in this lineup, fascinating in completely different ways and with completely different aims for their character and their movies. But they both created characters that stay with and engage the audience and gave us some of the most memorable moments of the year. In regards to Julie Harris, let's get to the elephant in the room right away. Yes, seeing a 27-year-old woman playing a 12-year-old teenager takes some time to get used to, but Julie Harris was right in her assessment that a certain level of experience is needed for the character of Frankie, and to be honest, she creates the illusion as well as humanly possible. Mostly because age itself never feels too important for Frankie. The member of the wedding does not really have a noteworthy plot. Rather, it feels like a look at the lives of these characters in this specific moment. There is a lyrical and poetic quality to their speeches, and it's therefore never relevant how old Frankie exactly is or how she should talk and behave.
I caught a glimpse of something out of the corner of my left eye. A dark, double shape. And this glimpse brought to my mind, so sudden and clear, my brother and the bride, that I just stopped and couldn't hardly bear to look and see what it was.
There is a strange fascination in what Julie Harris does here, giving a sound to the often difficult words of the play and holding nothing back, making Frankie a very unpleasant character whose fate and struggles, however, remain engaging.
Oh, I know you love us and that we love you.
We, when you say we, you only mean you and Jarvis, and I'm not included.
Frankie, you're spoiling our wedding.
No, I'm not. I'm not. Take me! Take me!
Critics were certainly right when they said that the member of the wedding feels very stagey. Not just because of almost just one single location, but also of how this location is filmed and how the actors' movements and positions are also clearly influenced by their stage work. Which does feel strange, as Fred Zinnemann was certainly not new to movie making, but it feels his affection for the material and respect for the performers occasionally led him to just sit back and watch without a clear guidance. But especially Julie Harris could have used more support in some moments. She is commendable for never holding anything back in her work, but the stage roots are too visible in Frankie's louder moments of anger and fury.
We will have thousands and thousands of friends. We belong to so many clubs that we can't even keep track of them all. We will be members of the whole world! Firemen! Man of Wands!
Child!
Especially next to Ethel Waters, who feels much more at home in front of the camera, and Brandon De Wilder, who acts with the appropriate innocence of a small boy because, well, he is a small boy, Julie Harris sometimes feels a bit out of place.
Isn't it shocking that Ethel didn't win for that role?
Yes, it is.
That was the great performance. Yes.
But I will say that Julie Harris nonetheless achieved many miraculous moments in The Member of the Wedding, demonstrating the raw quality of her acting and her overall talents. Especially when the camera rests on her face, Julie Harris feels much more relaxed and restrained, and her work with her dialogue is a thing of beauty. Her smooth voice can run the entire gamut of human emotions effortlessly, bringing the right amount of seriousness and childlike wonderment to her part. Her anger at the other girls who won't let her join their club, her incomprehensible joy about her brother's fiancé, or her famous We of Me speech.
I never did get it right as far as I thought.
A lot of other people thought you got it right, both in the stage and in the film.
And I used to say to Harold, I want that to be simple and just true in some sense. He said, well, it's like a prayer. And that helped me an awful lot. Because it was just like when you suddenly say something just, that means a lot to you and very quietly. And that's what it was like. It was, I love the two of them so much because they are the we of me. So it was a sort of realization and a prayer.
Till this afternoon, I didn't have a we. But now after seeing Janice and Jarvis, I suddenly realize that the bride and my brother are the we of me. So I'm going with them. I'm going with them and joining with the wedding. This coming Sunday, when my brother and the bride leave town, I'm going with them to Winter Hill, and after that, to whatever place that they will ever go.
Having played the character more than 500 times already with her co-stars, the chemistry between the three principal players is obviously excellent. Ethel Waters might overshadow the other cast members by the sheer force of her presence, but never intentionally. Instead, everyone works in great harmony with everyone else, taking center stage when needed, but giving everyone else room to breathe as well.
If I have to be me for the rest of my life, I think I will go crazy. Sometimes I feel like I just can't breathe anymore.
Frankie is a strange character, and Julie Harris gives an equally strange performance, but one that feels complete, thought through but not calculated, emotional but not sentimental. She's never afraid to be unlikable, and there is clearly no vanity in her work that would prevent her from giving it her all.
Frances Adams, you're gonna try that stunt once too often.
I warn you to quit picking with me.
You just ain't fit to live in a house.
I won't be living in this one much longer. I'm gonna run away from home.
Good riddance to a big old bag of rubbish.
You wait and see. I'm leaving town.
Where do you think you're going?
I have seen The Member of the Wedding a couple of times by now, and I'm still not sure what it exactly wants to say or how the character of Frankie relates to it all. But Julie Harris' work has stayed with me, for its honesty, complexity, and sheer dedication.
And we belong to be together. I love the two of them so much, because they are the we of me.
Now to Shirley. As I already said, the performance also occasionally feels stagey in some parts, but unlike Julie Harris, it's not in her bigger moments, but rather in some smaller scenes. some close-ups that don't feel adjusted to the intimacy of the camera, some of the things that were praised as realism in 52 a bit too forced. But this is really just a small criticism, because overall, it is a heartbreaking tour de force that rightfully caused such a sensation.
Well, I don't know what else to think, Ed. I'm scared. I'm awfully scared. If I need you later on, will you come over?
Lola is, in my opinion, actually not that interesting or rich a character. She is the suffering wife, suffering from the alcoholism of her husband, suffering from her lost youth, and suffering from the thoughts about her dog Sheba, who ran away a long time ago, but she still keeps calling for.
You know what I just thought I saw? A little Sheba. But it was just some little gray dog.
But watching Come Back Little Sheba, it becomes clear how much thought and work Shirley Booth has put into her performance, and how everything that makes Lola interesting and unique comes directly from her. Watching the TV production of Come Back Little Sheba with Joanne Woodward makes this clear immediately. Lola can be, due to all the personal misery around her, too much to handle, too exhausting, and this comes across too strongly in Joanne's work. Shirley Booth, however, by the sheer uniqueness of her on-screen personality, can inject Lola with an intriguing presence. Yes, she is still too much, doesn't know when to stop, when things become too intense, when it would be better to say nothing, but Shirley Booth balances these aspects with her own style and rhythm, living every facet of Lola's life without ever appearing to follow the guidelines of a script, resulting in a perfect match of character and actress, one that casts a shadow on everyone else bringing this part to life.
My losing her like that, the way it turned out, you wouldn't have had to marry me.
Honey, what's done is done.
But it must make you feel bad sometimes to think you had to give up your studies and support a wife.
Even though this is the first movie Daniel Mann directed, Come Back Little Sheba feels much less stagey than The Member of the Wedding. It's not a masterpiece by any means, and critics who criticized the thin plot and obvious symbolisms were certainly right, but it does come alive in the performance by Shirley Booth, who really carries the whole thing from start to finish.
All of a sudden I saw a little Sheba. She was lying out in the middle of the field, dead. I felt terrible, Doc. Nobody else paid any attention, but I cried and cried.
But while this is obviously high praise, it is actually also criticism. On the stage, Come Back Little Sheba was constantly referred to as a tour de force for two performers, and this is clearly how it was intended. But this did not happen on the screen. I don't want to blame Burt Lancaster too harshly here, he certainly put a lot of effort into his performance. But the problem is that he and Shirley Booth are totally out of sync every moment they share on the screen. They are not Joan Crawford and Jack Palance, but rather Bette Davis and Sterling Hayden. Their acting never completes each other. Shirley Booth clearly still plays Lola as if she was married to Sidney Blackmer and never adjusted her work in any way to her new co-star. Director Daniel Mann most likely had no interest in guiding her in this regard, only wanting to capture everything that Shirley had done before on the stage. But because of this, their shared love, their regrets past and present, their whole life together never ring completely true. The movie would have benefited instead from a more cooperative performance by Shirley Booth. Burt Lancaster's work is very straightforward, while you sense her experience with her character at every moment, resulting in a much more domineering performance, occasionally throwing the movie off balance.
Remember the homecoming dance? When Charlie Kettlecamp and I won the Charleston contest?
Mm-hmm.
Remember how mad you was when he thought he ought to bring me home afterwards?
I did not get mad.
Oh, yes, you did.
It is therefore wise to focus your attention on Shirley and only Shirley. And it's therefore not surprising that she is most effective when she is either by herself or during the later scenes with Burt Lancaster, when her desperation and his rejection are much more visible.
Please come! He's got a knife! No, Daddy! No, no, Doc. Please, Daddy.
That's right, telephone. Tell the whole world that I'm drunk.
Worrying about her husband getting drunk again, calling her emotionally unavailable parents, or simply remembering her lost dog, Shirley Booth creates some of the most moving scenes in cinema history that will break your heart in ways you haven't even thought possible, opening herself up to the camera completely, swallowing her whole part with every inch of her body and voice, but constantly staying fragile, insecure, and unforgettable.
I miss her so. She was such a cute little puppy. Wasn't she cute?
Yes, she was cute.
Remember how white and fluffy she used to be after I gave her a bath? And how her little hind end used to wag from side to side when she walked?
She's also not afraid to make Lola unbearable in many moments, but, as already mentioned, knows how to avoid making her uninteresting or two-dimensional in these scenes. Playing Lola as an often annoying woman without falling into the traps of an annoying performance.
Now, you sit right there and be quiet.
Why shouldn't I be quiet?
Nothing, Doc.
Nothing, Doc.
Doc? You sure you're all right?
Of course I'm all right.
Doc, where have you been?
And what business of yours where I've been?
Daddy,
Just let me alone. That's all I ask.
The character of Lola might not be rich, but the performance by Shirley Booth is, giving her dimension beyond the written word and creating a performance that feels definite for this character. In complete control of every scene, a woman desperate to be loved and to give love, caught in a life she both chose and feels trapped in. Shirley Booth took the suffering wife cliché, a role that could easily have been ridiculed, and gave her life and dignity, moral dedication, regret and hope.
Come, little Sheba. Come back. Come back, little Sheba.
After the approval by the Academy, neither Julie Harris nor Shirley Booth started a significant Hollywood career. But why exactly? Well, it can be summed up that neither Hollywood nor Julie or Shirley themselves were too eager for it to happen. The times of Hollywood specifically recruiting stage actresses for promising film careers was more or less over. Of course, producers did not say no when a unique Broadway talent came along, but stars did not have to come from the stage anymore. Which was fine for Julie and Shirley, who wouldn't appear in front of the camera again for a couple of years. Hollywood most likely would have had various ideas what to do with them, but they both knew that these ideas were limited and not what they wanted for themselves. The stage was where they found success, where they excelled in, and where they wanted to be. Shirley Booth had built her career in the theater, and Julie Harris would follow her footsteps, becoming one of the most respected Broadway actresses of all time and a permanent fixture at the Tony Awards, with a record-setting 5 wins for Best Actress in a Play.
Julie Harris.
What could Hollywood have offered to Julie Harris? She knew that her appeal as a leading actress in movies was different than on the stage. Looking like this in your movie debut might bring you respect, but most likely not a significant Hollywood career. The Member of the Wedding was not a star-making introduction to Hollywood like Roman Holiday or Streetcar. Movies did not only showcase talents, but also immediately gave producers an idea on how to use this talent next. Instead, it emphasized everything that Hollywood most likely considered false about Julie Harris, her looks and appearance. The contrast between Julie Harris as Frankie and Julie Harris the actress was obvious, but for many columnists, not big enough to give her 1950s movie star qualities. She was often described as thin and small, certainly not a Marilyn Monroe type, but also without the glamour of a, say, Audrey Hepburn. Gossip columnist Sidney Skolsky described her as a shy, sensitive person, afraid of strangers, and Luella Parsons wrote, she never met a more nervous, ill-at-ease girl than Julie Harris. She was, as newspapers said, the antithesis of a famous actress.
I should hope not. I mean, have every sort of adventure, be the most wonderful, fabulous personality.
And Julie Harris herself also said that she was a classic wallflower. Skinny, awkward, self-conscious, and very unhappy about how she looked and sounded on the screen. Much more secure on the stage, where she felt looks don't matter the same as they do in movies. If she had consequently focused on a movie career, it would most likely have been a frustrating experience for her, not enjoying the same kind of freedom as Hollywood would have tried to find a specific type for her, that she would have had to play for the rest of her life. On the stage, however, she could play almost every character she wanted, saying, "It never gets boring." With each new audience, It's a new experience.
Queen Victoria, Mrs. Lincoln, Eliza Doolittle.
Yeah.
I mean, we can go on forever.
Well, I've been very lucky, yeah.
Oh, and you just created these different, wonderful characters.
Has that been important to you, the versatility?
Yes. When I first loved the theater and was attracted to it, I thought, well, actors are like children in that they can go into the attic and open up the trunk and say, ah, here's a jester suit, I'll be a court jester. Oh, here's a crown, I'll be a king, and so on.
Julie Harris essentially focused the main energy of her career on the stage, with occasional jobs in movies or on TV in between, when there was a gap in her schedule, and only playing movie roles she actually wanted to play. Most of them may be neglectable, but some well remembered, like in the James Dean picture East of Eden or the horror classic The Haunting. But even with more than 40 movie credits, Julie Harris never had that one moment when the respect for her theater work garnered her an Oscar-winning role like Jessica Tandy.
Were you at all concerned about comparisons to Jessica Tandy?
And she also didn't receive Oscar nominations basically every time she appeared in a movie like Geraldine Page. Maybe because the camera wasn't able to capture the strengths of her acting the same way the stage could. One review of I Am a Camera stated in 1955, at a distance in the theater, Julie Harris is skilled enough to be deceptive. In biggest live close-ups, however, she rubs the wrong way, and what looked volatile and spontaneous before now looks superficial and thin.
Why do you paint your fingernails green, for example?
Well, to attract men. That's why. You know, to feel their eyes running up like mice.
In the end, Julie never turned her Broadway successes into movie or Oscar successes. Three of her Tony-winning roles, The Lark, The Last of Mrs. Lincoln, and The Belle of Amherst, were TV specials. Her Tony-winning role in 40 Carats was given to Liv Ullmann. And the film version of I Am a Camera is mostly known today for the review Me No Like Her, and the movie didn't make any impression on awards voters. Because even if you do react award-winning stage parts on the big screen, this doesn't mean that the success will automatically be duplicated. In 1991, Mercedes Rule won a Tony for Lost in Yonkers over Stoker Channing in 6 Degrees of Separation, but when both actresses recreated their roles in the movie versions in 1993, only one of them was invited to the Oscars.
Stoker Channing in 6 Degrees of Separation.
And in regards to Julie Harris, the shift from the 60s to the 70s saw in general less interest in movies based on plays. Of course, with some exceptions, by the time of prestige Broadway dramas coming to the big screen every year and sweeping the awards season was more or less over. And if such opportunities came, they were taken by other stage actresses, maybe more at home on the big screen and able to shine just as brightly. Even on the stage, Julie Harris, unlike for example Geraldine Page, was never noted as a domineering actress. Rather, she invited the audience to slowly discover her themselves, a delicate creature earning your attention. In the medium of motion pictures, this kind of presence can easily be self-defeating and only suitable for a limited environment. Some stage actresses are able to transfer their varied talents and presence with equal skill to the big screen, without losing any of its power or feeling limited to a certain style. Others simply are not.
When I got to do a play, I was happy.
You were at home.
I was at home.
And I thank also the audiences who came to see it, who gave us back so much love that it made, besides having my child, the most exciting experience of my life. Thank you.
And Shirley Booth? Her case was obviously different because her age was already an almost insurmountable handicap, but no matter if 40 or 50, an actress like Shirley Booth would be difficult to cast as the kind of leading lady she had established herself on the stage. Hollywood most likely could have given her a more extensive career than she ultimately had, but not in the way she would have wanted. Her success in Come Back, Little Sheba had established her as that rare leading character actress in the tradition of married wrestler. But how many roles would Hollywood actually create for her? She most likely would have been seen as a wisecracking supporting player, similar to Mae Robson or Selma Ritter.
Artie Pooper.
But like Julie Harris, Shirley continued to prefer the freedom of the stage, which, at least for now, gave her more and better opportunities, and she remained skeptical about Hollywood. Because her insecurities about her age were most likely not only started by her fears of missing out on theater roles, but also because Hollywood casting decisions had sent her very clear messages right from the beginning of her career. Her big stage hit, Three Men on a Horse, was turned into a movie in 1936 with Joan Blondell. The Philadelphia story went to Ruth Hussey. My Sister Eileen, Rosalind Russell. Goodbye My Fancy, Eve Arden. Shirley was passed over for younger actresses with more appeal on the big screen than her, again and again. In an interview around the time of the release of Come Back Little Sheba, she told a newspaper, "I have a mirror. I know why Hollywood never wanted me. I never pined away for a screen job because I was sure they didn't have room for a person like me, a character actress who had no resemblance to a movie queen." Shirley knew what Hollywood wanted and what it didn't want, and its disinterest in her as a performer very likely had increased her insecurities about her looks and her age. It's therefore not surprising if she considered making herself younger a necessary step to avoid similar disinterest in New York as well. A question of survival. And if she saw it like that, then it had worked. By 1952, she and Julie Harris had firmly established themselves as highly respected leading ladies on a Broadway stage. If Hollywood considered their appeal limited or downright useless, New York certainly did not. Instead, it gave Julie Harris the kind of diversity she was longing for, and Shirley Booth the kind of demanding leading parts she was used to by now. Both actresses were sure that careers like theirs could only have happened on the stage in the first place. After all, following her Oscar win, Shirley Booth again received the confirmation that in Hollywood, it made no difference if she was 10 years younger or not. She just did not fit in. In 1955, her stage hit The Time of the Cuckoo became Summertime with Katharine Hepburn, and Katharine Hepburn would then take another role that Shirley had created in Desk Set 1 year later. And there was no outcry about these casting decisions, making it clear that Shirley's movie career was essentially already over again. So despite her Oscar win, Hollywood was a source of grief for Shirley for her entire career, and it's therefore not surprising that she continued to prefer the stage and only took a few leading movie roles producer Hal Wallace offered to her. In 1954, she starred in About Mrs. Leslie, which tried to give her a more glamorous image, probably to see if she could be used in other roles than the eternal, quote, slatternly housewife. Shirley, however, did not care too much for this attempt to change her image. "Now I have to come in early, put on these fancy clothes, and have a big makeup and hair session. I'm not sure I didn't like it the other way." By the time Katharine Hepburn was announced as the lead in Summertime, the interest in Shirley Booth as a movie actress had basically faded, and producer Hal Wallace had also moved on. Shirley was maybe America's answer to Europe's wave of realism, but Wallace now had the real thing when Anna Magnani made her American movie debut in The Rose Tattoo, and his priorities shifted. Shirley wouldn't appear on the screen again until 1958, when she made her last two movies, Hot Spell and The Matchmaker, which would later become a small musical by the name of Hello Dolly. Shirley also noticed that the campaigns around the movie focused more strongly on her younger co-stars. For her, it was the end of Hollywood. But unlike before, Shirley would not find new inspiration on the stage because, as she had feared for so long, the number of offers from Broadway finally began to decline as well. But like she had done before, she went where she felt appreciated, and the offered material matched her demands. "I had to go where people believed in me, and I had to keep acting so I could believe in myself." But what was maybe just a last attempt to keep going, eventually became the most remembered role of her career.
Say, do people, what do they yell to you on the street when they recognize you? Does anyone say Miss Booth, or do they always say...
No, oh, it's always Hazel.
It is?
Yes.
Yeah.
And I love the idea of doing it. The only thing is I'm awfully sad now because there's a commercial on the air, which people think I do, and I don't do at all. I have somebody impersonating my voice.
That's not true.
And they keep
thinking,
you know, I'm making thousands and thousands of dollars, and I'm not doing it.
That's not you who says I'm the maid at the Baxters?
No, no, it isn't.
I'll be darned.
It's my understudy from Philadelphia Story.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Yeah. But how can they get away with it? I thought there was a...
Well, they can't get away with it. I'm suing them.
Obviously, Shirley Booth was not the first prestige actress to lower herself in the eyes of Hollywood and New York by working on TV. Loretta Young had already started her own TV show almost a decade earlier, and Barbara Stanwyck also had her own show by 1960, but there was a difference between an actress doing an anthology series with her name in the title or playing a maid in a mere sitcom. And so, many of Shirley's colleagues reacted with shock to this new phase of her career. Her Sheba co-star Burt Lancaster went so far to tell her he was ashamed of her for cheapening herself.
Fuck you.
But Judy Garland would later defend her by saying, if Shirley Booth can be cheapened in any way, they haven't invented the medium to do it yet.
Do you appear on television?
What? No?
Who doesn't?
And again, Shirley Booth's instincts were right, when Hazel became a big hit that ran for 5 seasons. And of course, it also won Shirley 2 Emmys, making her one of the few performers who achieved the triple crown of acting. The 1962 Emmys were also another occasion where the paths of Julie Harris and Shirley crossed as they both took home trophies for their TV work that year.
Do you ever get tired of the Hazel reference of people in the street saying, do people
well,
say, do you,
I'm a little bit depressed over the fact that since I've done Hazel, I've done several things, thinking I could create a variety of things. For instance, I did Look Through the Lilies, which was Lilies of the Field, and I worked so hard to get a German accent and to walk with it and, you know, do all these things, and people would come back and they'd say, oh, we enjoyed it, but we'd love you as Hazel. You know, I might just as well have stayed home.
Do you appear in a weekly series?
Yes.
Miss Kilgallen?
Did she say yes?
Yes.
Dead on those. Is it a situation series?
Yes.
Mr. Sir?
Is it a program that is presently appearing on the CBS network?
No.
No!
4 down, 6 to go, Miss Francis.
I have caught the timbre of the voice. Shall I pass and see if they can get it?
Yes, yes. That's so fun. Let's
see. Yeah, because I'm sure I know who it is.
All right, Mr. Lawrence.
Are you the star of this weekly series?
Yes.
Miss Kilgallen?
Do you play a domestic?
You mean thing.
Of course, the role of Hazel today defines the heritage of Shirley Booth more than her acclaimed stage work or her Oscar win. The role made her accessible to a larger audience than ever before, and it feels that today, many forget her versatility as a highly acclaimed character actress who could be the suffering wife, a tourist longing for love, or a sarcastic sister. But for Shirley Booth, it was a warm experience, and she cherished the fact that Hazel brought her new popularity and steady employment. After her work on the show, Shirley would slowly retire from acting. As a performer, she always wanted to play likable, relatable characters and only in productions that were in accordance with her own morals. And the times were against her. Tennessee Williams offered to write a play for her if she would appear as the Madam of a brothel, which she declined, and she did not react positively to many Broadway productions of the 70s. On the big screen, she apparently lost the role of an elderly stowaway in Airport to fellow Broadway legend Helen Hayes and did not receive any relevant movie offers anymore. But neither Shirley Booth nor Julie Harris needed a movie career to validate their standing as true acting giants. Hollywood might not have been interested in what they had to offer, but they shaped their careers according to their own ideals.
It does strike me, though, that your devotion to the stage has remained unchanged. Don't you feel it's rather sad that Brando has abandoned his original career and he's now, when I say just a film actor, I'm not demeaning the role of the film actor, but if only he could have kept up both.
Well, but I've stopped superimposing my desires onto other people. Yes, it would have been wonderful if he could have been a great stage actor, but that wasn't what he wanted to do.
But it is what Julie and Shirley wanted to do. Not every stage performer has the urge to also have a big movie career. Actresses like Colleen Dewhurst, Irene Wurst, or Uta Hagen all achieved acting immortality only due to their work in the theater.
I'm very pleased to be here tonight for this annual celebration of my lifelong passion, the theater. I made my debut in 1937 And now, 50 years later, I'm still playing.
At the end of the day, every career is different and every performer has different ambitions.
What would you advise someone today, a young woman who wants to go into the theater or into movies or, you know, become an
actor? If she had to come to me for advice, I would say don't try it.
Why?
Because she has to have that much determination herself. I mean, I never went around to everybody as a young woman saying, do you think I should do this? No, 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 no. You have to have a go, because there's nothing you can tell anybody. Everybody's path is different, a different way of accomplishing it, different circumstances, and certainly today it's a different world.
Both Julie Harris and Shirley Booth maybe had a few significant movie performances, but they clearly preferred the stage, and they took work that fulfilled and appealed to them. They switched mediums as they liked, when they wanted to, and how they wanted to, but with different priorities. And their triumphs clearly speak for themselves.
About 20 minutes ago, we had a wire from the coast saying we've been very good boys, and we've been upped in our time from a minute and 15 seconds to about 25 minutes for you to make a speech.
Oh, well, it's...
Popular win. Bless you.
Thank you.
Julie Harris has won 5 Tony Awards. She is faithful to the theater and is a national treasure. Miss Julie Harris.
Julie Harris.
Oh, Julie Harris.
Very talented girl.
Yes.
Very talented.
When Julie Harris was asked, what would you do if the world came to an end tomorrow? She answered, I'd go to the theater. Regarded as an actor's actor, Julie Harris would describe her feelings about her profession as, I am addicted to my work, my craft. I do my best work when I am filled with a sense of mission toward the audience. When I am involved with something that they must be made aware of. If someone has invested time and money to watch me, and if he isn't impressed or moved by what he has seen, then I have failed him. And if I fail him, I fail myself.
That's why I feel so lucky to have been able to find something that really does fulfill me, because acting has always been a great source of joy to me, because I, from the time I was little, I loved watching actors, I loved seeing plays, I loved watching movies.
It's clear that neither she nor Shirley Booth ever failed their audiences, but engaged them their entire lives with their diverse performances and undeniable talents that let them shine either on a big stage or a small movie set, and that gave dimension, depth and honesty to every part they played. These words might have been about Julie Harris, but they feel spoken for both her and Shirley Booth.
She has left us a remarkable gallery of brave and bewildered souls. Acting isn't what she does, it is who she is.